Welcome back to the Community of Innovation podcast brought to you by the Center for Aging and Brain Health Innovation, otherwise known as CABHI. I'm Allison Sekuler, President and Chief Scientist at CABHI and the Baycrest Academy for Research and Education.
And I'm Rosanne Aleong, Executive Director of Research, Innovation, and Translation at the Baycrest Academy and the Director of Research, Innovation, and Translation at CABHI. Over the coming weeks and months, we'll be doing a series of special bonus episodes from our 2023 CABHI Summit. For today's episode, we're featuring Dr. Brent Chappell, a radiologist and a slam poet from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. In his powerful and moving keynote address, Brent inspires us to understand why Alzheimer's research and innovation matter. So, Allison, a very, very powerful keynote from Dr. Chappell. Yeah. What stood out for you?
I think what stood out for me, and people will, you know, see this themselves when they hear him talking and see him, is just the raw emotion of it, the power of it, the vulnerability with which he's describing, I don't want to give anything away, but the experience that he went through and that his family went through, the way he personalized this story. Mm-hmm. And so each person really has their own story when it comes to Alzheimer's and related dementias, but, you know, we do have commonalities across them. And I think that no matter what your individual story is, you know, you may see some parts of yourself, in his story, or you may have a completely different story, but even though it's so personally, it still is, I think, a really universal message that he's conveying. So what stood out for you?
I think his honesty. He is brutally honest throughout his keynote, sharing so much detail. So I felt a lot of gratitude that he was willing to share that depth of his experience. Yeah. I also admire that, you know, he is sharing it as a call to action for future generations. Yeah. He's actually wanting his experience to inform his family, his children, others in his community. And so he's really taken an opportunity to share for the betterment of others. And I think that really stood out throughout his keynote.
Yeah, the selflessness, really. That's yes. And wanting to make the world a better place for everyone. Yes. And other people being able to benefit from, you know, his family's pain, frankly, his family's challenges, yes. And to see how he can turn that into something good for the world. I thought that was really powerful. So let's let people judge for themselves and let's get right to this episode.
I'd like to talk to you today about research into Alzheimer's disease and other dementias, but not about the science of that research or even the numbers that drive it, the number of lives lost, number of families devastated, number of dollars spent on long-term care. Instead, I want to talk in a personal way about why Alzheimer's research matters, why it really matters, why it should matter to all of us as human beings. In the past, I don't think I would have been the right person to speak about the human side of this. For nearly 40 years, I have been a man of science, a physician, and it's been mainly through that lens that I've looked at the world. Certainly how I've looked at Alzheimer's. But then two things happened. First, people in my life, people I love, got dementia. And second, through a strange and wonderful series of happenstances, I got drawn into the world of spoken word poetry, also known as slam. Even more strange and wonderful, eventually I became a poet myself. Or maybe it's more true to say that the poet who had always been there inside me, buried under all the biology and chemistry and physics, woke up. And Brent the poet turned out to be way better than Brent the radiologist at thinking about and understanding and even speaking about what matters. A couple of years ago, Brent the poet was thinking about dementia and wrote this. I had a dream, a nightmare, where you wake up sweat stuck to the sheets, your heart pounding, your foggy brain straining to tell if it was real. I'm at work, reading x-rays, and there's this man looming over my shoulder. He seems important, like maybe a visiting professor. And he shows me a chest x-ray and asks what I think. No big deal. We do this. We put our heads together. So I tell him. But then he shows me another, and another, and another. And then it hits me. Is this a test, I say? Yes, he says. People have been talking. There have been concerns. My wife's mother had dementia. Hers was called Pick's disease. The name suits it because it picks at your brain like a carrion eater, taking certain bits but leaving others. In her case, it was beyond cruel, devouring huge swaths of her, but leaving a razor-sharp awareness of how much she had lost. And it also left untouched her great strength and pride, so she stayed proud enough to be unable to accept this shell of herself, and strong enough to sit in her cottage for what must have been hour after hour after hour, scratching at her crumbling memory for the words, to write last letters to her children, and then put on her coat, tighten the hood around her face, and walk far out into the lake. When I went into that bright, white room and they pulled back the sheet and said, "Is that her? Is that Margie Mahalina?" I hesitated. "Yes," I said finally, "I suppose it was once." Her mother had it too, and lay for a dark decade in a nursing home bed, her husband of 60 years visiting every morning at 10, talking to her and holding her hand, except for the days she pulled away, because she didn't want to be touched by a stranger. So it's in the family. And when my wife beats me at Scrabble, she says, looking over her shoulder, "Do you let me win?" "No, love, I don't let you win." And I pretend to grumble, "But I'm so glad you still do." And now my father has it, and is getting pretty bad, so he doesn't remember much. But he remembers how to swing a golf club, and his body hasn't failed him, so we still golf together. It's not the same, though, because golf is mostly walking with someone, and our walks are so much quieter now, because I can't ask him anymore what I'm doing wrong in my backswing, or how exactly you tell a person they have cancer, or what he had for breakfast. So we just walk. I was writing a poem recently, and I went to write the word jet, so I wrote J-E-T. But it didn't look right on the page. I wasn't sure J was the right letter, because I wasn't sure. I couldn't quite remember what sound a J makes. It was a small thing. It only lasted a few moments, and I don't scare easily. But that J stared up at me with the cold, steady gaze of a psychopath. And I was truly afraid. I think I was probably about 16 years old, maybe even 18, when I finally realized my dad wasn't perfect. Up to that point, I thought he could do anything he put his mind to, because good God, what a mind. Obviously, I'm biased, but I really do think Dad was the smartest person I've ever known, and I've known some really smart people. He was just good at thinking, about anything it seemed. Thinking about medicine, for sure. He was a physician, a surgeon. His colleagues called him the surgeon's surgeon. If another physician, especially a surgeon, was ill and might need an operation, they usually called on Dad. And not just because he was skilled with his hands, though he surely was, but even more importantly, they knew he would think things through. He would figure out what was really wrong, not jump to the seemingly obvious diagnosis. And then he would carefully reason out what the right course of action was, not necessarily surgery. Surgeons do love to cut, and sometimes they jump right into the cutting, even when it might not make the most sense. Dad took great pride in the times he thought about a patient's situation and decided it was better to set the scalpel aside. First, do no harm, Hippocrates said. The whole world of medicine forgets that all too often. Dad never did. And it wasn't just medicine. It seemed that his mind could sift through whatever was in front of him, the right bid in a game of bridge, the right move on a chessboard, world affairs, business and investments. Well, okay, maybe not business and investments. He was a physician. We don't have the best reputation there. Pretty much everything else, though. You might have noticed I'm talking about my dad in the past tense. The truth is, he is still very much alive, still here, in the present. But it's hard not to talk about his mind in the past tense, because it is, almost entirely, gone. Sometimes, Alzheimer's charges ahead like a freight train. Carolyn Bray, the wife of my lifelong best friend Scott, was diagnosed with Alzheimer's a couple of years ago at the age of 61. A year later, she was dead. A horrible, nasty, brutish death. Dad's illness has been much more gradual. A blessing, you might say? I suppose, in a way. But to me, more like a purposefully slow form of torture, death by a thousand cuts. I think I was the first one to notice something was wrong. Dad and I went on a golf trip to Scotland together, bucket list kind of thing. I hadn't seen him in a while, and during the trip, it struck me that something just wasn't quite right with him. The keenness, the sharpness of him seemed the tiniest bit dulled. That was 23 years ago, and since then, so many steps, an uncountable number of steps, inexorably downward. Those walks on the golf course are gone. The walks around the neighborhood where he lived for 35 years, near the hospital where he worked for 30 years, are gone too. His body can still walk pretty far, but his mind can't. My sister Karen and I went to visit him recently at Sherbrooke Community Center, the nursing home where he lives now. He was having a good day and was able to manage a walk down the hall, and we came to the shuffleboard table. He seemed interested. He used to like shuffleboard and was good at it, like he was at everything, so we reminded him what to do. His hand remembered how to hold the disc, but his first shot fell right off into the gutter, and he said, "I'm so stupid. I can't do anything. I want to go." For years, it's the second most common thing he says to us. Number one, "I love, love, love you." Number two, "I'm so stupid." It's such a grotesque and cruel irony, isn't it? One of the very few things his mind can still do is to understand that it can't understand anything. I don't know if I can properly describe the horror of watching someone you love be eaten away like this. It's like a priceless work of art being defaced. Like graffiti on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, like a Stradivarius left out in the rain, like bird shit on Michelangelo's David. And of course it's a horrible tragedy if this happens to anyone, any of the legions of people who've been struck down by it. It's an unfathomable and precious miracle what any of our minds can do. But why did it have to strike him? Why did it have to destroy that beautiful, beautiful mind? He should still be kicking ass at bridge. He should still be discussing the subtleties of Pinot Noirs at wine club. He should be living in his own home with his wife who misses him so much she can hardly breathe. He should at least know who she is when she comes to visit, for God's sake. He should know that my daughter Georgia, his granddaughter, is now a surgeon herself. He should be sitting with her by the hour discussing sutures and incisions and forceps and how exactly you care for a patient, how you deeply and truly care for a patient. He should still be helping me with that. Even at 89, he shouldn't have to feel stupid and helpless. Alzheimer's kills people. Millions of them. Well, then kill him. Please, take what's left of him. I can't believe I'm saying this because I will miss him so much, but I already miss him so much. I want him to just not wake up one morning. I'm not sure I can bear to see him suffer like this anymore. I'm not sure I can bear to see any of us who love him suffer like this. Here's the deal. We need to figure this shit out. We need to understand what's happening to my dad's brain. We need a treatment. We need a cure. We need to find a way of stopping this from ever even beginning in anyone. We need to make dementia research a priority like we have for heart disease and cancer. We need to make sure the people who do this research have everything they need. We need to revere them. It's not optional. Because how it is now for my dad, for the countless other people with this god-awful condition, how it is now is not okay. It's not. It's not just what happens when you get old. Listen. The research will pay off. I know it will. I've seen it pay off with other diseases. Of course, it's going to take time. The money my wife Susan and I donate to Alzheimer's research today isn't going to help Dad. It probably won't help us. But we see it as a gift to our daughters, who live with the dread of the twin genetic ticking time bombs we have so unwillingly given them. Until then, until that earth-shattering eureka moment in some lab somewhere someday, or more likely, until 1,000 tiny eurekas on 1,000 different days come together to free us from this never-ending nightmare. We need help. We, the people who have or will have dementia, we, the people who care for or will care for those who have it, God, we need help. So I am incredibly grateful that there are organizations working very hard to provide that help. Organizations like the Alzheimer's Society of Canada and the Alzheimer's Society of Saskatchewan in my home province. They do provide support every day to people like Dad and the families of those people to help us survive, maybe even thrive. And I'm immensely grateful that organizations like CABHI exist, supporting researchers and innovators looking not just for a treatment or a cure, but for new ways to help people with dementia in their everyday lives. Somewhere out there, maybe at this summit, is a person with an idea for a technology that could have helped Dad find his way home when he got lost on a walk, or a better way for us to find him when he was lost, or a way to guide him to the bathroom when he woke up at night, disoriented, or to stop him from wandering out of the house, into the cold, into traffic. On New Year's Day this year, Dad walked from his room in Sherbrooke out into the common area, and in front of the people gathered there, other residents, visiting loved ones, my dad, my previously smart, capable, dignified father, pulled down his pants and defecated on the floor. I think he just forgot where the bathroom was, or he forgot that people don't do that. Could there be someone out there who could find a way to help him with that, to help the good people looking after him with that? I don't have the faintest idea how you would do it. Put a sensor in his butt that sends an alarm to the nurses? I don't know. But I say this to the people working in this field, racking your brains, scratching and clawing for funding. Don't give up. Please, I beg you, do not give up until you find a way to help my dad with that, with all of it. I know for some of you, this is just a job. Maybe you even see the epidemic of dementia as a business opportunity. But I'm guessing for most of you, it's personal, like it is for me. So my heart goes out to you for the suffering in your families, among the people you love, the suffering that drew you to this work, to this summit today. One last thing. To government, to philanthropic organizations, to individual ordinary people, I say this. Brilliant researchers do give up all the time. They have to. There is just not enough money to allow them to continue. It's a disgrace how underfunded Alzheimer's research is. And there is no more pressing, no more urgent problem than this. You think it's bad now? My generation is coming. The baby boomers, this massive swath of humanity born of a time when parents could imagine a bright future, is coming. And when we get Alzheimer's in all our numbers, there won't be enough nursing homes, enough care aides, enough technology. Our lives will be devastated. Our families' lives will be devastated. Our dementia will be an ever-growing juggernaut spreading devastation throughout our whole society, throughout our whole world. We all need to act now. So let's get on with it.
Thank you for joining us for this special episode of the Community of Innovation podcast. We also want to thank our podcast production team, including Monique Chang, Nicole Pacampera, and our friends over at PodTex.
To learn more about CABHI, please visit us at CABHI.com. That's CABHI.com. We'd also love your support of our podcast, so please subscribe on YouTube, SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your pods. And if you want to support CABHI further, you can donate at baycrest.org/donate to CABHI. That's baycrest.org/donatetocabhi. We will be sure to add the address in the episode show notes. We also want to urge you to follow Brent's call to action to support individuals living with dementia and their families in your community.